Now, the next item of business is a debate on motion number 15172 in the name of Shona Robinson on redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities. Members who wish to take part in the debate should press the request speak button now, and I call on Shona Robinson to speak to and move the motion. Ms Robinson, you have up to 10 minutes.
I'm pleased to have the opportunity to open this afternoon's debate and just want to move the motion in my name at the start of the debate. I want to take the opportunity to describe my longer-term vision for primary care, building on Sir Lewis Ritchie's recent report and the many innovative new ways of working which have been developing across the country. First of all, I want to explain our delivery plan. I want to set out how we're going to make the vision a reality and how all parts of the system will need to work together to make it happen. First of all, though, I want to take the opportunity to thank all of those working in our health and care systems, particularly at this time of year with the pressures that winter brings, and I know that our staff work particularly hard over that period. And although we are talking about primary care today, I would want to take the opportunity to also thank our hard-working health professionals working within our A&E departments, which have today delivered on the four-hour target. And I think that is a huge achievement and something I'm sure will be welcomed from all sides of the chamber. But also within our primary care sector, we have a huge number of people working very, very hard. And I absolutely understand some of the challenges, and we'll hear some more of that this afternoon. But what's important is that we are very clear on the way forward to ensure that our primary care services are robust and are sustainable and able to changed and developed to meet the changing demands that are going to be required as we go forward. Sir Lewis Ritchie's report on the out-of-hours primary care was published on the 30th of November, and I warmly welcome the findings. And of course, we've announced an initial investment of £1 million to begin to test his new models of care, and I'll come back to that later. Through our programme for government commitments, we also identified 10 examples of test sites for change in primary care, and work is progressing across all of those. For example, the Lothian Headroom Initiative, focusing on improving outcomes for people in economically disadvantaged areas of Edinburgh. I'm also going to test 2 community health hub sites in Fife and Forth Valley, in which we'll focus on the interface between primary and secondary care. And through trusting our GPs and delivering on our commitments, when I spoke at the RCGP conference on the 1st of October, I promised GPs that I would remove the outdated quality and outcomes framework, the QOF, from their contract. And I was delighted to announce this morning that, working closely with the BMA in Scotland, we've delivered on that promise, and that QOF will cease to exist from April next year. This will help to free up more of the GP's time to be focused on essential patient care. So we've moved to do some very quick developments, but there's obviously more that has to be done. And we need to go further, and we need to go faster, because Scotland is changing, and people who need healthcare are also changing. We're living longer, which is a good thing, but all too often a longer lifespan brings with it more complex health needs and reduced quality of life. Meanwhile, people quite rightly expect to access the right care by the right professional quickly when they need it. And I hear something that our primary care practitioners say. They sometimes feel they have too much to do and not enough time to do it. Statistics published today show that while the number of GPs working in Scotland has increased by 9% since 2005. The number of patients over 65 has also increased by 18% over the same time period. Our out-of-hours primary care services are also relied on by hundreds of thousands of patients across Scotland each year. Yes, of course.
Dr. Simpson.
I welcome the publication of the figures today, but it's regrettable the fact that we don't actually have the full-time equivalent numbers, because the headcount, I think, is something which is not reflected in the full-time equivalent, and it's the full-time equivalent that really is critical. I wonder if she has that figure.
Cabinet Secretary.
No, but there is a survey, of course, that's going to be taking place, which I think will provide more depth of analysis of some of the data that Richard Simpson is referring to. Now, I accept that there are significant recruitment and retention challenges within general practice, and that we need to build and maintain the workforce, and that's why from 2016 we are increasing the number of training places for GPs by 33%. That's why we're investing in a programme to encourage GPs who have left the practice to return to the workforce with investment this year. And of course, we're investing in GP recruitment and retention more broadly in order to make general practice a more attractive career option. As we move forward into next year, health and social care integration is presenting us with a huge opportunity to do things differently. And my vision is of primary and community care very much at the heart of the healthcare system, with highly skilled multidisciplinary teams delivering care both in hours and out of hours, with a wide range of services tailored to meet the local area, with that care taking place within locality clusters, and with our primary care professionals being involved in the strategic planning of our health services, and with the people who need healthcare being more empowered and informed than ever and taking control of their own health, able to directly access the right professional care at the right time and remaining at or near home wherever possible. And we're already heading in the right direction. We know that up to a quarter of people seeing GPs are suffering from soft tissue injuries. That's why every person in Scotland can now call NHS 24 and get advice or be referred for physiotherapy if required. And that's an example of the kind of change that we need across the system. I want to set out my plan for making the vision a reality. I mentioned earlier Sir Lewis Ritchie's review of out-of-hours care, and I want to record again my thanks to Sir Lewis for his work. And I know that he worked closely with many stakeholders, including the BMA, the Royal College of Nursing, pharmacy representatives, NHS chief execs and others. And Sir Lewis told us that we need to do more and have better multidisciplinary working, with more investment in the workforce, more investment in infrastructure, and a drive towards changing the culture. And he centred this around a model of urgent care resource hubs. He said that we need large-scale tests of change, moving quickly to a whole system change, and he's right. My initial £1 million of investment will allow us to begin the process of testing, and we'll publish the National Implementation Plan in the spring of next year. And this will coincide with the integration of health and social care, further enabling just the sort of joint working that we need. Our detailed budget plans will be published by the Cabinet Secretary for Finance tomorrow. I'm not going to preempt that. I certainly wouldn't dare. But I can say that I'm determined to see primary care expenditure rising. We've already announced a new £60 million primary care fund. And I want to go further than that. I want to see the balance of health spending changing over time so that a greater percentage of funding goes to primary care. That's not a short-term change, but one which will continue throughout the current process of transformation. From within the £60 million primary care fund, over £20 million of that is going to provide a kick-start to some of those major tests of change that Sir Lewis said we needed. Some of the first things we're going to do to test are fundamental changes to the GP contract with our key partners across the Inverclyde Health and Social Care Partnership area. We're working to develop and test new ways of working. I hope very shortly to be able to announce to you the details of this work, which will draw upon the knowledge of those working locally to identify the changes that can be made. And that will help us realise our vision for the future role of GPs and others in primary care and ensure improved outcomes for everyone. And that will make a difference not just in Inverclyde, but across Scotland. And of course, we are investing £100 million for mental health over the next 5 years in the run-up to 2020, £10 million of that within a primary care setting, which could look at developing new ways of working, like the distress brief intervention. I want to move on to looking at changes we're making affecting GPs and other parts of our valued workforce. We absolutely value family doctors incredibly highly. We want them to stay in the profession. As I've said before, the time has come to start talking up Scotland's general practice to encourage more doctors to stay and to ensure medical students choose a career in general practice. I think the future for GPs lies in them having high-quality jobs focused on undifferentiated presentations or working out who may need further assessment, investigation or referral, caring for people with multiple conditions, and, of course, quality and leadership. Other health and social care professionals will provide the care they are best placed to provide. That future is a win for patients who get to see the right person at the right time, and for all of our healthcare professionals who can make the most of their skills and knowledge. We've been working with the Scottish General Practitioners Committee to redesign the GP contract, and I want to thank Alan McDevitt and his colleagues for their work. And of course, as I said earlier, we've now removed the QOF system as of 2016. We'll take the opportunity that this process presents to focus on tackling inequalities in a more effective way. And I know that's something that is shared across this chamber. And we'll have the first version of the new Scottish contract in place by April 2017. So by then, we'll have made significant progress to change the way general practitioners work. We'll remove the annual churn of contractual change and introduce the next version of the GP contract 3 years later in 2020, when this transformation in the way GPs work will be near complete. Our model of multidisciplinary working has implications right across the workforce for community nurses, advanced nurse practitioners, allied health professionals, pharmacists, practice staff, and those working in new emerging roles. Our community nurses can, and in many instances are already, leading and coordinating both care management and specialist services. I want to see more of that, and the Chief Nursing Officer has recently begun work to transform and develop nursing roles so that they can meet the current and future needs of Scotland's people. And let us not forget the important role that pharmacists can play, not only as clinicians in their own right, but as a crucial part of that multidisciplinary working. Up to March 2018, over £16 million will be invested from the Primary Care Fund to recruit up to 140 additional whole-time equivalent pharmacist independent prescribers. And these pharmacists will free up GP time to spend with other patients. And we need to get the basics right too, like IT systems that are fit for the future and flexible premises. Over the period to March 2018, I've allocated £6 million of funding to the Primary Care Digital Services Development Fund, and this will be focused initially on increasing the availability and uptake of online appointments and repeat prescriptions. So, in summary, this transformational change plan is multifaceted, it's ambitious, it will take us a long way down the road that we need to travel. But these changes will not achieve anything without the people who really make our Scottish NHS what it is. And I want to end where I started, and that's by thanking all of those involved in the journey so far. I also want to put on record my thanks to Richard Simpson. I had a very helpful meeting with Richard the other day, and he is someone who has brought a lot of experience in primary care to this chamber, and I think that will be missed after the election next year. But I hope, perhaps in some way, that he might continue to share his experience with us as we move forward with these important changes. So thank you very much, and I look forward to hearing what members have to say in this afternoon's debate.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I now call on Dr. Richard Simpson to speak to and move Amendment 15172.2. 10 minutes, please, Dr. Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I draw members' attention to my declaration of interest as a member of the BMA and Fellow of the Royal College of General Practitioners? This is a welcome debate, and I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her kind remarks. I'm slightly regretting the fact that the first third of my speech is going to be quite negative, but the remaining will be quite positive. So if she could maybe dwell on that for a minute. The government motion, I think, doesn't recognise actually the extent of the urgency which the Cabinet Secretary has now put into her speech, and I think it remains a slightly complacent motion. The current national conversation, for example, is very similar to what Labour proposed in 2011 as the Beverage Commission for the 21st century, although such a commission would have been more independent of politicians. Our proposal was rejected out of hand by the SNP on the grounds that it would take too long. Yet here we are. My first call for a new GP contract was made in 2010, rejected not only by the government but the BMA. The reason for making that call at that time was twofold. One was because the Tory plans in England were creating a totally different approach to general practice with commissioning groups. But also in Scotland, I was hearing, anecdotally, that the number of applicants for partnerships in general practice had reduced to a level which had not been seen since the early 70s. If we look at the Labour government in Wales, it did set up the Bevan Commission, similar to what we were proposing, and the result has been that they do have now 64 funded clusters. The government will no doubt have studied the Labour Welsh Government's document, A Planned Primary Care Workforce for Wales, on the further development of these clusters. But in Scotland, meantime, we've experienced an increasing population, as the Cabinet Secretary referred to, increased birth rate, increasing numbers of over 75-year-olds with multiple and complex conditions, increasing demand, as evidenced the growth year on year in GP consultations, and a largely unresourced transfer of work from secondary hospital-based care to GPs, and an increasingly bureaucratic quality outcome framework, which I'm delighted the Cabinet Secretary has agreed to remove early before the contract. I think that's a welcome move. But, you know, the response of the SNP in the last few years to preparing for this transformational change that I think we're all going to agree is going to be worthwhile has been to cut the nursing student intake. And nurses are going to be vital to this transformational change. They cut the midwifery student intake as well. I recognise that this is not an easy area, and I think the government's establishment of the out-of-hours review by Sir Lewis Ritchie was a very welcome first step and has resulted, as is usual for Professor Ritchie, in a thorough piece of work with achievable objectives. And I do welcome the pilots that is going to occur, though I'm slightly concerned about the level of funding, which I've queried before. The government's announcement of the £60 million funds for new models of general practice to be tested is very welcome. The 140 pharmacists are also welcome, although I would like to know how people apply. I'm getting GPs phoning me up saying, we'd like one of those, how do we get them? And I'm finding it difficult to give a response. So some detail as to exactly how they're going to be put in place will be welcome. I know they're going into the 2C practices that have been taken over, and that does test the model, and that's excellent. The other thing is, of course, the delay in recognising and acting on the deterioration in general practice over the last 5 years in terms of recruitment and retention means we urgently need further action now. Increasing the GP training places sounds very good, but as there are 20% vacancies, I'd really like to know from the Cabinet Secretary, how is she going to actually get people into these posts since 20% are currently this year unfilled? The action on the deep end practices, I think, is also something that's quite urgently needed. And the Cabinet Secretary did allude to that in her speech, but I think we do need a lot more detail. It's evident from the paper published last week about the discrepancy in funding for these practices, and I think that really needs to be addressed as a matter of urgency. I am told these practices, although they haven't yet collapsed, as some others have, are nevertheless extremely fragile, and their sustainability is quite questionable. And I have to say to the Cabinet Secretary that she gave me an answer to a written question about a risk register for general practice in which she believed, because I don't doubt her belief, that there was a risk register in every health board. I have to say, I've subsequently repeated my FOI. The first one said that there were 7 or 8 boards which did not have such a risk register. And I have to tell her there are still 3 that don't have them. Greater Glasgow and Clyde have said, we will now start. But I have to say that's another recognition of the fact the problem has really not been followed through on. Now, I have some suggestions, and many of them are in the paper which I produced and which the Cabinet Secretary was kind enough to have some discussions with me, and I think I'm to have some more discussions with, and that's a Labour paper based on our survey and review and consultation with GPs. The boards should now start to contract retained banks of GP locums and other primary care staff. Now, where are they to come from? There are a lot of sessional doctors out there, and doctors who have almost retired, to have perhaps a family break, a break to have a family, who could be recruited into a bank of locums to provide at least short-term cover for short-term absences of sickness. Now, evidence of this, actually, this approach is already materialising, because with the Bannockburn practice closing, the practices in Stirling have rallied round, and the sessional doctors there are providing some of the locum cover already. So there is a willingness amongst colleagues to support other local practices in difficulty, and I think that needs to be built on. We need a national performance list today, tomorrow, or certainly this week. We can't wait. That's in Lewis Ritchie's report, and it should be acted on now. Local performance lists to which doctors have got to apply to individual boards is outdated, outmoded, and must be done away with. We should have a reversal in the cuts in the medical undergraduate places and establish a graduate entry medical course. That will take a little longer. But the nurses, which I want to return to, are really absolutely critical to this. We have a situation of 1,900 vacancies. We need another 350, although not all of them now, for the family nurse partnership, but that was the original number and they're not all recruited yet. The RCN reckons we need another 500 for the named persons situation. So that comes to about 2,500. And yet, there were 640 fewer nursing students enrolled in universities since the start of this Parliament. In fact, this is one area where the Cabinet Secretary is not able to stand up and say we're doing better than Labour. The numbers are actually 476 down this year on the last year when Labour left office in terms of recruitment. We cannot actually have this transformational change without having an adequate number of students. Now, the increase in the uptake of return to work for nurses is welcome, and I hope that that will be built on. I think we need to have negotiations now, if they're not already taking place, on how to incentivise senior GPs not to retire. We need a modernisation now in the bureaucratic revalidation scheme. This is an intensely workload element and is particularly a problem for senior and experienced GPs who really don't need this level of revalidation. And I would strongly suggest we should have discussions with the GMC immediately about moderating this bureaucratic process. We need an immediate revitalisation of the GP retainer scheme. With the gender shift that we've had, one would have expected there to be more retainer GPs and retainer schemes. It was originally called the Women's Retainer Scheme when we were more or less PC and gender specific. But the scheme has had a 40% drop. And yet the number of women qualifying in medicine is up from 10% in my time to over 50% today. There should be post-registration work placements for every allied health professional. I know the government doesn't control the intake, but actually putting them into work placements now would help some of the elements the Cabinet Secretary has mentioned. This essential workforce training contract measures must be underpinned by a national infrastructure programme using a combination of NPD and GP financed, backed finance. For example, the innovative scheme in Tayside to close the Aberfeldy Community Hospital, but to open beds in a care home, which they're going to build. That sort of combination might work in Portree, where there are problems at the present time. And Stirling's Care Village is another example of a joint NHS local authority venture, which is very welcome. Cabinet Secretary mentioned IT, and improving the IT links to pharmacy should be an immediate priority, along with the links to optometrists who are now prescribing. The system of clusters advocated by the Royal Colleges 9 years ago, endorsed by the King's Fund as essential, and reported by the Commonwealth Fund survey of 10 countries as being essential to greater satisfaction and delivery in general practice, these clusters need to be established quickly. And I know we've got 10 pilots, but I think we need to look at what's happened in Wales and try and adapt that. Presiding Officer, I only have about 30 seconds left.
I still have a
way to go. Sorry?
I can give you an extra minute or so.
Oh, that's very kind of you. Thank you very much. These practice or locality groups were variously referred to in different documents as clusters, networks, federations and family care partnerships are showing themselves to be absolutely crucial in delivery. The Tower Hamlets work has been extraordinary over the course of 7 or 8 years in the changes they've made to one of the most deprived communities in the United Kingdom. We need to have support from specialist nurses, advanced practitioners, physician assistants, allied health professionals and pharmacists covering conditions such as diabetes, COPD, asthma, heart failure, end-of-life care and polypharmacy. But I would ask the government in terms of looking at these clusters to publish the details of what they're doing so that we can actually have a full discussion on that and see how it's going. The objective, of course, will be to a fully resourced shift in the balance of care from acute hospitals to a modernised, integrated community health and social care service fit for the 21st century, designed to reduce admissions and prevent a return to growth in acute beds. There are clearly funding restraints, but the next Parliament will need to consider how we address the reduction in the primary care share of the budget and the effect upon the infrastructure in the community of the capital cuts that we've had to sustain. Shifting the balance of care cannot be achieved without a significant shift in the balance of resource. I have one suggestion which doesn't involve money, and therefore I don't have to have approval from my Cabinet Secretary for Finance, and that is the efficiency savings, which are still running at 3%, although they're difficult, the non-recurring aspect of that, part of that should be designated as being applied to primary care. That would achieve a shift, because the majority of the savings will be from the major part of the budget, which is still in the acute sector.
I do need you to close now, please, Dr.
Finally, Presiding Officer, I hope the Government will publish a set of principles with which it seeks to underpin any new contract. The task is a daunting one, but if we all work together, then I hope that we'll be able to achieve that transformational change. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you,
Presiding Officer, for the time.
Many thanks. I now call on Jim Hume to speak to and move Amendment 15172.1, 6 minutes or so. Mr. Hume.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd also like to associate myself with the words of the Cabinet Secretary regarding Richard Simpson, and hope he does continue to have an active part, and I'm sure he shall. I also want to start today by also praising the extraordinary work that frontline community health and care services professionals put day in and day out across Scotland. So I think it's a timely debate to have today. We want to raise the importance of primary health services. They're a valued asset that needs, I think, some urgent attention. We know there was an investment of £40 million in the primary care fund announced in 2014 November, but that took the best part of 7 months to put words on paper and solidify that very action. And that action turned out to be reducing the amount announced that would be invested on primary care from £40 million in 2015-16 to £16.6 million per year over 3 years. But that aside, the Cabinet Secretary obviously wants to talk about redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities, and the record shows exactly that. Sorry that we have to start slightly negative, but we'll go on to be constructive. £26.5 million was cut from the primary medical services since 2009-10. Almost £30 million was cut from the total spend on GPs in that period of time. And out of our GP funding was cut from £95.7 million in 2008-09 to less than £80 million in 2013-14. And these are figures the Cabinet Secretary provided to myself just this month in a PQ. So clearly a redesign is exactly what's on the government's mind. However, of course, I don't want that to be of the wrong kind. One thing which the government does acknowledge is the challenge in recruiting and retaining GPs, a challenge brought on by perhaps a lack of investment in primary care and to establish the recruitment practices that are needed. The chair of the Royal College of GPs said, and I quote, "There is no question that the consistent underfunding of general practice has contributed to the difficulties the services face. RCGP has been warning for over 2 years now of the results of year-on-year cuts to the percentage share of NH Scotland's funding allocated to the service. General practice, which sees 90% of all patient contact with the NHS, received just 7.6% of the budget. Such imbalance is a plan for failure." End quote. And today, with new figures out that the average GP practice list sizes have increased by 10% since 2007. So perhaps that goes some way to answer Richard Simpson's questions on full-time equivalents. So it would be interesting to hear of the figures that the Cabinet Secretary does find on that very figure. So we don't want to just play lip service, of course. There continues to be little success in attracting GP trainees in the necessary numbers. While I'm sure, surely welcome the announcement of adding 100 more GP training places, I would also like to receive assurances from the Scottish Government regarding what plans it has made to fill those places. If the current places are not being able to be filled with GP trainees, as Richard Simpson says, what's the plan for the 100 additional places going forward? In September, the Cabinet Secretary told us that in 2015, of the 305 GP speciality training posts advertised in Scotland, only 237 were filled. And research presented in the British Journal for Medical Practice shows that the majority of GP trainee places were in the least deprived 25% of practices, with the most deprived 25% having just over half that number. These deprived areas are the areas where multi-morbidity and premature mortality are a real problem, where mental health problems are a factor in a third of GP consultations, a third, and where, in fact, funding doesn't match clinical need. GPs at the deep end warn that the flat distribution of GP resources throughout Scotland doesn't benefit those who are in need of GP care the most. This is the 8% of the Scottish population living in the most deprived areas. So unless a drastic shift is applied to address inequalities in the current resource distribution methods, I don't think we'll see a change in the health inequalities themselves. So, of course, I'm not referring to throwing money at the problem and expecting solutions to just magically appear. A guided and educated approach is needed that does take into account the needs of both practitioners and patients. A fully resourced workforce that works in the right way and in the right place is a call also backed by the Royal College of Nursing and the out-of-hours primary care review. As the Cabinet Secretary will be aware, the report's recommendations 8 states that clearly that a national primary care workforce plan should be developed and implemented without delay. So, Presiding Officer, the redesign of primary care for Scotland's communities must be precisely this, a redesign for the communities. We're facing next year a project of an enormous scale, the integration of health and social services, who will jointly manage £8 billion worth of assets and resources, a redesign that has to take into account the localisation of services and the ability of integration authorities to plan their workforce needs and be supported while doing so. The Ritchie report proceeds to point out the need for robust workforce planning to be urgently replicated at NHS board and integration authority levels to ensure a sustainable and empowered multidisciplinary workforce. So the Scottish Government has to redesign services with regard as to the real needs of the populations in different communities across Scotland. Unless that changes in a way that enables and empowers practitioners to plan for their patients, I think we'll see very little progress on reducing inequalities and putting our NHS on the right footing for progress, a strong, future-proofed NHS. I move the amendment in my name.
Many thanks. And I now call on Jackson Carlaw. 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin where the Cabinet Secretary did, by paying tribute to the staff who will be working extremely hard over the winter and over the Christmas season. I know I've remarked before that I very much doubt they're watching our debate this afternoon. They'll be far too harassed, and if they're not, I hope they've better things to do in many respects. But I hope that they understand that that tribute is heartfelt and well-meant, because I think over the last 2 or 3 winters, we've come to appreciate that the demographics are changing so rapidly that if there is any major health concern emerges, a pandemic of any kind whatsoever, it places enormous strain on the hospitals and on our NHS staff widely. Can I say that I've thought long and hard and decided not to table an amendment to this afternoon's motion, and that we will support the government's motion. And I did so because there is no point in me going to meetings of nurses and allied healthcare professionals and doctors and saying to them that I'm going to take the health out of politics and then coming along here and being highly belligerent about the position we are in. There's a distinction between the day-to-day health issues, where I might have issues with the government, and the strategic plans for the future of the health service, where I think it's necessary that we stop being partisan and that we seek to find as much common agreement as we have. And I begin really, I suppose, but I will, however, since it's Christmas, support Mr. Simpson's amendment this afternoon, albeit that I've read his Fit for the Future document, and I'm supporting your motion, your amendment, Mr. Simpson, but there is a whiff of Labour said, Labour did, Labour thought, if only we'd listened to Labour, yada, 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 we wouldn't be where we are today. I don't think that entirely gives measure of the issue and the problem that we collectively face. I noticed somewhere in Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie's report, which actually, although it's an out-of-hours care, I think its themes reach right across the whole primary care debate, but towards the back of it, there is an age demographic laid out. And I noticed that in 2039, when, if I were to have lived that long, and I've cheered the chamber up previously by making clear Carlow men don't, and I would be 80 years of age, there would be twice as many people of the age of 80 by that date than there are today. Whereas my sons, who would then be in their 40s, there will be just as many people in their 40s as there are today. And I think we constantly understate or fail to paint a picture which people properly grasp of just how huge a shift in the demographics of the Scottish population we have lying ahead, and what a revolution is required in our whole approach to primary care, where so many of these elderly people are part of a detailed patient cohort and need so much individual attention and just that bit more time, and the effect that that is having on primary care. Can I say one of the most encouraging things, though, is you can get into that kind of approaching old man syndrome. And I've spoken to people in the professions who say, oh, the trouble is all these new doctors coming through now, they just don't have the same commitment and work ethic that we had when we came in. I mean, we believed it was a vacation. We would work through the night if it was necessary. And this new lot, my goodness, you can scarcely drag them out their beds to meet the shift that they're supposed to be on. And I was very encouraged last week to meet both the leader of the Scottish Junior Doctors and the leader of the Scottish Junior Student Doctors. And I was enormously impressed to find absolutely that that is not the case. But what has changed is there is a different perception of the work-life balance across all of Scotland and the workforce going forward. And that therefore we have to ensure that the contract renegotiation and the structure for GP primary care that we put in place is one you can't dragoon people into. It has to be one we attract people into. And that's why the job that the Cabinet Secretary has ahead of her is so important. And I have to say that Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie, when he says the funding will not grow in line with the service demand, makes a very important point. There therefore has to be, and I'll touch on this as well in my closing remarks, there has to be so much more focus put into the preventative agenda, which stops people having to see a doctor in the first place. So much effort that has to be put into the whole NHS asset, beginning with community pharmacy care and the role that they can perform, which potentially alleviates the pressure on GPs. And I was very attracted by the whole resource hub and the emphasis Sir Lewis Ritchie puts on the definition of urgent and emergency care, and our job as politicians and within the health service to educate the public to the difference. Because too many in the moment are dissatisfied, rightly or wrongly, with the, as they see it, the level of primary care provision and the opportunities that there are for that. And it was very interesting to read in his report some of the patient responses as to why they don't access various services at the moment, many of them prejudicial rather than factually based, but some real things that need to change there too. But it was interesting to see that we are driving people to hospitals, not literally, but making them go to hospitals in their own mind, rather than using the whole network that exists. And it reminded me again that one of the things Scottish Conservatives have advocated is that along with the annual council tax bill, there should be a health board statement in each region which details what has been happening in general terms with healthcare in that region, but also directing again as much as we can and educating people as to the correct access point for the service need that they have at any given point. I will come back later on to other points, but I want to finish at this point by saying this is the great strategic health debate and strategy decision that we have to make. It will, I think, dominate the next Scottish Parliament. It's worth and essential getting it right.
Thank you very much. We now turn to the open debate, speeches of 6 minutes, please. And I call Nigel Dawn to be followed by Margaret McCullough.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I start, as some others have, by thanking the staff who work in our health service? I'm very conscious that I speak here as someone who represents fairly widely flung communities across Angus North and the Mearns, and I shall speak from that position. I'm very conscious that the staff who work in my local facilities themselves have transport difficulties when everybody else has a transport difficulty. They also, of course, suffer health issues themselves, and somehow or other, in their various communities, they make it all work, and we're very grateful. I'd also like to thank Jackson Carlaw, actually, for his approach, because I do have to say that I entirely agree with the idea that across Parliament we really should be able to agree on our strategic planning, because, quite frankly, if we can't, we've got it wrong. The timescales are just so long. The inertia in the system is just so big that we actually have got to get this right in principle, and we've got to understand each other's position. Presiding Officer, my communities do have within them a number of hospital facilities, which I sadly, even in this time, don't have time to discuss. But what I would bring to the Chamber's attention, and to the Cabinet Secretary in particular, is that folk like a local facility. The Cabinet Secretary will be very well aware, for example, that Brechin Infirmary is under some threat at the moment. It's next to a GP practice. The GP practice is, for its own reasons, not able to sustain that local cottage hospital, community hospital, if I may use that. And I want to talk about community hospitals because they are a necessary add-on to GP practices. And I have, I think, five of them. My folk like a local community hospital. They are used to a local community hospital. They value, therefore, local hospitals, but they recognise it has a cost. And the costs are in two ways. First of all, because there is a relatively low occupancy, and sometimes these facilities are not even occupied, there is a significant unit cost, if I may use that, to describe how we look after a patient. But far more importantly, I think, where staff are effectively underutilised, they are also very rapidly de-skilled. And I think that is a point which health boards need to get across to the communities. It's a problem that we had, and I met it first a long time ago, when we were looking at ambulances up the rivers, in particular up in Braemar and Ballater. You can have an ambulance at every stop, but the people do so little, they rapidly become de-skilled. And that's one of the constraints that we need to make sure folk understand. If I then look at Sir Lewis Rich's review, I'd like to pick up on one or two of the important points that he raises. I'm sure others will pick out on many of them. The huge potential for shared records is one of the things that I'm seeing as an opportunity, but also as a bit of a concern, because sitting on the Public Audit Committee, I do get the impression that sometimes records are not as shareable as they should be. The boundaries between health boards are, we recognise, artificial. In the middle of my constituency, they are wholly arbitrary. And we must make sure that the IT systems work in such a way that records can be accessible. Solis also talks about video links and recognises that there are often cultural barriers to the use of video links. It seems to me that if the doctor can't come to your bedside, it might be entirely reasonable that the nurse can with the appropriate video link. We don't seem to be making use of that as much as we should. Turning now, Presiding Officer, to what I see as the biggest risk. I commend the Cabinet Secretary and the Government for what they're trying to do. But integration joint boards do seem to me to come with a risk. And I say that not alone, but because the Auditor General, in one of her very recent reports, also takes that view. I have absolutely no doubt that everybody concerned wants to make them work. But I do have a concern that when you get at a leadership level and at a governance level, people who come from other organisations, which may well have primary responsibility for some aspect of what you're trying to integrate, then it's got to be very difficult for them to know which hat they're wearing at any point in time, and for the integrated services to become the dominant factor in their thinking. It seems to me that the leadership of our integrated joint boards is going to be absolutely crucial. It's relatively easy to come up with a vision statement, a document, but turning that vision into changed processes, changed expectations, both from staff and patients, and then changed satisfaction levels because the expectations have been absorbed, is surely a huge concern. I'm hoping that we can find leaders who will make that work. I'm hoping that we can instill in them the the idea that this has to be for the whole population and not for the small section which they previously used to look after. But I do want to be concerned, Presiding Officer, that we get that right and we get the governance right. To say I have no doubt the government's intentions are entirely correct. I have little doubt the legislation is right, but leadership does seem to be crucial. Summing up, Presiding Officer, it seems to me that the doctors, the nurses, the pharmacists, the physiotherapists, the advanced nurse practitioners, in particular district nurses, the social service and care workers, who are going to be part of the integrated services which we rely on in future years, come in well motivated. I am absolutely sure, and I think Jackson Carr commented on this, that people want to do a good job. I find it inconceivable that anybody goes into those caring professions not wanting to do a good job, not wanting to develop their skills and to provide. So all the government has to do is to provide them with an opportunity to contribute. Our job, I would suggest, is to make sure that they can effectively, to ensure that governance around them is going to be effective. And I commend the Scottish Government's determination to make sure that they can. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm afraid there's not a lot of time in hand this afternoon, so I ask members to keep to 6 minutes. Margaret McCullough to be followed by Sandra White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In beginning my contribution today, I also want to put on record my appreciation for the hard work and dedication of GPs. We as a society depend on their skills, their experience, their hard work and their sense of duty towards others. They are an invaluable profession. They are essential and their dedication should be acknowledged by the whole Parliament today. Presiding Officer, before dealing with issues concerning reform and redesign of services, I also want to draw the Chamber's attention to the members' debate which Patricia Ferguson had secured at the end of last month. In that debate, we heard about the challenges facing so-called deep end practices, where the consequences of the health inequalities are most acute and most severe. The life expectancy gap is a stubborn and stark reminder of the extent of health inequality in Scotland. The Labour amendment allows me to repeat the point I made in the Chamber last month, which is that we need to do much more to understand the financial consequences of health inequalities for our public services and for health budgets. And we need to properly support practices on the front line in our struggle with health inequality. There is no doubt that the causes of health inequality are complex. Tackling those root causes is not simply a question of resourcing GP practices. It's also a question of redistribution, regeneration, education and economic opportunity. However, the BMA and researchers from both Glasgow and Dundee universities have shown that practices in the most deprived areas have 38% more patients with multiple morbidity. They've also shown that average spend per patient in those practices is lower than in more affluent parts of the country, and GPs in deprived areas tend to have a higher workload. This is why so many of us have called on the Scottish Government to examine the allocation of funding. Presiding Officer, there is no doubt that our health services, including primary care, must overcome significant challenges if we are to make them fit for the future. There is a consensus on that point across the Chamber, in our healthcare professions and throughout the wider public sector. Demographic change, a rise in workload, developments in medicine and medical technology, and pressures on funding all necessitate change in healthcare. There is also a broad consensus about the principles which should drive the necessary reforms: preventative spending, shifting the balance of care, delivering new models of primary care closer to the community while developing specialisms and expertise in acute settings, making better use of our pharmacists, our nurses and our allied health professionals. All of this is common sense, but none of this is new. Let me quote some recommendations from a report by one of the UK's leading health experts. In planning the future of the NHS in Scotland, we need to ensure sustainable and safe local services, redesign where possible to meet local needs and expectations, specialise where required, having regard to clinical benefit and to access. View the NHS as a service delivered predominantly in local communities rather than in hospitals. 90% of healthcare is delivered in primary care. but we still focus the bulk of our attention on the other 10%. Preventative care rather than reactive management. Development of new skills to support local services. Generalists as well as specialists, nurses and allied health professionals as well as doctors. This could have been an extract from the Minister's speech or from a recent briefing from the BMA, but it isn't. It's from a report by Professor David Kerr for the Scottish Executive published over a decade ago. I don't believe that the pace of change we have seen in the years since that report was published matches the scales of the challenges before us. If it did, then we would not be where we are now. 32% are considering retiring from general practice. 92% say their workload has negatively impacted on the care patients receive. Primary care share of the budget is going down. In acute care, we also have reports of a crisis in medical recruitment and in A&E. In NHS Lanarkshire, we are even seeing out-of-hours primary care services centralised under a government which promised to keep health local. The Health Board isn't driving reform from a position of strength. It's reacting to a shortage of GPs who are willing to work in that service. It's all reactive and it has been for too long. Presiding Officer, I believe that many of the challenges in our health services face today, whether in primary care or acute care, are related and they have been foreseeable for some time. Negotiations over the new GP contracts are of the utmost importance, as are the questions of resources and training. I commend Richard Simpson's work in these issues. We need to shift the balance of care, but we cannot do it unless we support our GPs with models of care which are fit for the future. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call Sandra White, to be followed by Drew Smith. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I do believe it's a very important debate today and I'm very pleased to be able to take part in it. And I do thank the Scottish Government, I think Jackson Carlow also mentioned this, for the content of their motion and in particular the recognition that it is difficult and challenging to recruit and retrain GPs. And I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to tackling this. I would like to, you know, reply to Dr. Simpson, who appears not to be here, but perhaps Margaret McCulloch also. We've heard about Hackney, we've heard about the Labour Party in Wales as well. Well, I think we should hear something about Scotland and what's happening here in regards to the care that we're providing. And basically, the notes that I took down before I came in here today, it's primary care in Scotland is outperforming other parts of the UK. I wonder why we don't mention that very often in a debate from the opposition Labour Party. Survey in 2013-2014, 87% of people in Scotland rated the overall care provided by their GP surgery as good or excellent, compared to in England, which was 85%. Now, I could go on basically about how good the health service here in Scotland is, but I'm not going to be petty the way the Labour Party appear to be petty today. I think their earlier behaviours could probably look towards some form of health care for themselves rather than anything else. And I think it was an absolute dereliction of duty to attack this Parliament and the presiding officer. But maybe they'll grow up in time. I'll leave that with the opposition Labour Party and let them go on with it. If I could just go further on to welcome the report, in particular the report by Sir Lewis Ritchie, the review there and the 28 recommendations that he actually made. I think it was Professor Mercer also. Now, one of the recommendations, recommendations 1-4, reflect the need for better innovative models. You know, basically, I think that's absolutely correct. Models of care which will improve coordination and communication. I think that's really important, communication. Recommendations 8-19, the need for compelling and pressing action to shore up and rapidly enhance the capability of an increasingly diverse and multidisciplinary workforce, which I think has been mentioned already also. And we must work and learn together more closely and effectively around the needs of patients and carers. I think that's really important. It is the patients and carers. Now, I emphasise the word carers. It's not been mentioned very much at all in the debate. But obviously, carers need help as well when it comes to health. Some of these carers are not in the best of health themselves, sometimes caring for elderly parents, sometimes caring for young disabled.
disabled children. So I think carers is an important part of that as well. And we must, as I said before, work together. But for me, the most important recommendation, and Nigel Dawn, I think, touched on this in his contribution, is the potential future roles of health and social care partnerships and integrated boards and integration. For me, that is absolutely the most important part of it. And if I could just continue on that theme regarding social integration, South Lanarkshire, I think, was mentioned before, obviously, Glasgow, Greater Glasgow Health Board is my particular area. Throughout local authorities, we do not have a level playing field in regard to social integration and what they actually deliver. Now, in my particular case in Glasgow, I have huge workload of people who are actually being kept in hospital because basically, and I can quote this, I won't quote the patient's name, but I can quote this from Glasgow City Council, social care, each area service is giving a set target, numbers of placements they can make in each month. Now, that doesn't happen across the board. So whilst we're talking about social integration to ensure that we don't have bed blocking, we don't have the NHS picking up the tab, that's not the way it's supposed to work with integration. But in Glasgow, it is working that way. And I think it's absolutely, well, it's actually sad in a way because people who should not be in hospital, who could be being cared at home, are languishing in hospital beds and they're not getting the proper care or treatment, which basically the hospital and the health service want to them out, basically because they think they could actually benefit from staying at home or in a care home, and yet they have the proof of it, placements that they make each month. And I would ask the Cabinet, no, I'm sorry, I won't take an intervention, and I would ask the Cabinet Secretary, when we're looking at, obviously, the primary care and we're looking at social integration, will we have numbers from each local authority that they are working together? Because I know in South Lanarkshire, they work very well. There's a very, very good practice in South Lanarkshire and also in West Lothian also. But Glasgow, for some unknown reason, seems to be lagging behind. Choice or not, I don't know. I've certainly tried to ask, but I haven't been able to get any answers apart from the admission that they do look at targets each month. And I would like the Cabinet Secretary to pick up on that particular one. I'd also like to ask in regards to, we're talking about practices, I'm talking about when people turn up, we had this in the report in the Equal Opportunities Committee about isolation and loneliness. And there were some cases where people, particularly elderly people, would turn up at doctor's surgeries, not because they were unwell, but because they had no one else to talk to and they were very, very lonely. Now, we were talking about looking at someone such as a link worker, which basically could actually identify that, which means that, one, the doctor's time would be, you know, would be eased, and a link worker could point these particular patients to some form of either voluntary service, because they are very important to the integration of health and social care, could point them to something which basically they would get the benefit out of. It would be beneficial to their health, both physically and mentally as well. So I just wonder, within this primary care and putting it down to lowest common denominator, would link workers be involved in this also? Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Many thanks. Drew Smith should be followed by Bob Dorris.
I'm grateful to you, Presiding Officer. The response from Professor Sir Lewis, the report from Professor Sir Lewis Ritchie is a good one, and I think it makes sensible points about the reform of out-of-hours primary practice. I also agree with much that has already been said by some of the earlier contributors, including Richard Simpson, about the extent of the primary care crisis. That said, I will support the government motion and the Liberal amendment later. But the points I wanted to make are about GP provision more broadly than out of hours, and specifically the issue of GP provision for the poorest places. And I'm assisted in this afternoon by an email I received yesterday from a constituent in general practice in Glasgow with expertise in homelessness and addiction health services. And Margaret McCulloch was right to raise the concerns that have been expressed really throughout this Parliament by GPs at the deep end. Now, that's a group I've met with several times. I know many members will have met with them. And I have to say, I've always been somewhat of a loss to suggest what practical change is actually coming that resolves some of the problems those GPs face. The constituent that got in touch with me yesterday particularly wanted to highlight some comments by Peter Costin on behalf of the deep end. And I hope it's helpful to the debate to hear some of them. At the beginning of this month, Professor Graham Watt published a paper in the BJGP which showed that the poorest 40% of the population with 47% more complicated multi-morbidity, that's either five conditions or more, or the combination of mental and physical health problems, receive 8% less GP funding per patient per year. Now, that's not only a matter of social justice, but has a profound effect on inflating the cost of running the National Health Service and indeed undermines the prosperity of the whole country. Because when those with the poorest health cannot access the same level of preventative and long-term care in the community that is enjoyed by the more affluent, they become sicker sooner and end up costing far more in hospital admissions and A&E attendances. If the average age at which the workforce develops long-term illnesses in some communities is 10 years before the age of retirement, then that has a devastating impact on both the local and the national economy. I was interested a few weeks ago, the First Minister, at First Minister's questions, answered a question about this, and she said, "I welcome Professor Watt's findings, which we will take fully into account in delivering a new GP contract for 2017 and the accompanying revised allocation formula. The new GP contract, on which we are in the early stages of negotiation, will take effect, and which will take effect in 2017, gives us a good opportunity to revise the allocation formula to ensure that it reflects the varying needs of GP practices." The First Minister quoted figures that day showing that the least deprived 10% of practices received a slightly lower level of payment per patient, £7.65 less per patient per year than the most deprived 10%. But, you know, Presiding Officer, that's only correct when you compare the extremes. Professor Watt's paper compared the poorest 40% with the most affluent 60%, i.e. he covered the whole of the patient population in Scotland. And what the First Minister did not mention is that complicated morbidity was twice as prevalent in the most deprived 10% compared with the most affluent. And none of that is reflected in the way that general practice care is funded. Dr. Costin has said it's time to move on from debating points about small differences in funding and to recognise the huge differences in premature morbidity across the social spectrum and the need to include that on a pro rata basis in the new contract formula. And this isn't about necessarily taking funding from affluent areas to give to poorer areas, because all practices have common cause in highlighting that during the last decade there has been a 20% reduction in NHS funding of general practice relative to the rest of the NHS budget. Quite simply, the focus of our National Health Service has been on additional investment in the most expensive parts of healthcare, i.e. in acute care, while disinvesting in preventative general practice care. The GP contract and the change to integrated health and social care must rectify these mistakes and ensure that general practice as a whole is funded in such a way that we do not withhold care from the poorest in order to ensure that we can continue to provide care across all areas of the country. And if we don't get this right, then we'll continue to fund an NHS that actually contributes to health inequalities and which becomes less and less sustainable in the long term. Now, my constituent and Sandra White might be interested, she talked about the reality of what's going on in the health service. Well, my constituent, who's a GP in Glasgow, working in economically deprived areas for 16 years, she says, "In many ways, I believe I provide a very good service and we have a high level of satisfaction amongst our patients. We recently surveyed patient calls and found that we had a 25% higher demand for appointments than the number that are expected nationally. We also found that we were providing 10% more appointments than the nationally recommended level." So it's no solution to her to expect those GPs working in the poorest areas simply to work harder. She goes on, "These are not the figures that worry me, however. I'm especially aware of all the people who aren't calling for appointments or have so many things to talk about when they see me that they neglect to mention those things that really matter, like an early symptom of cancer. Many of my patients have learned to survive adversity by having very low expectations and by accepting that they are old when they are in their 50s. They are the people who are paying the true price and ultimately with their lives for maintaining the status quo." Presiding Officer, unmet need is what we should be focused on, and I certainly commend the work of the Deep End Group to members this afternoon, given that, unlike the government motion, the Labour amendment actually mentions the issue of differential funding. I'll be supporting Dr Simpson at decision time, and I would commend others to do so.
Many thanks. I now call Bob Doris, to be followed by Nanette Mill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know that there are significant challenges in delivery of healthcare, given the demographic trends which present us with an ever-ageing and increasingly frail population. We celebrate a longer life expectancy, but must show determination to boost poor statistics in relation to healthy life expectancy, and other members have mentioned that also. We also know that the vast majority of older people wish to stay in their homes as they get older and more frail, with the support as required for as long as possible. And it is also true that as part of that process, we also want to see a shift from spend on the acute sector into the primary and community sector and care there. However, can I strangely then commend a spend in what at first glance looks like an entrenchment of spending in the acute sector, and I refer to the £200 million investment to enhance capacity at the Golden Jubilee Hospital in Clydebank, and the creation of 6 elective surgical hubs across the country. As we have an increasingly ageing and frail population, the need for cataracts surgery, the need for knee replacements and hip replacements becomes increasingly important to sustain older people in their homes for longer. And if we don't take the strategic decision now to increase capacity, whoever the government is in 5 years' time or 10 years' time will be told that planning just wasn't in place 5 or 10 years ago, and that's something that's been taken, a decision that's been taken now, and fundamentally is also connected to making sure that we can sustain people in community social care for longer. So I would like to kind of put that on the record. What I would note, however, is that in the context of health and social care integration, how that interacts with the acute sector spend is something that I think we have to do better on. I note that only 2 of the integrated joint boards actually have acute sector spending as part of their combined budget, and that's Dumfries and Galloway, and that's Argyll and Bute. And I think maybe other integrated joint boards are missing a trick there, because after all, these integrated joint boards are going to be looking at rehabilitation and enablement services for older people in communities. They're going to be looking at slip, trips and falls prevention at home, and the acute sector, whether it's emergency treatment through the door of A&E, or whether it's early intervention and preventative surgical interventions through these new acute hubs. I think there has to be a better integration of funding in relation to that, and I don't think perhaps we've necessarily got the balance right. But that is, of course, a decision for the integrated joint boards, and I do accept that. Can I welcome, actually, the real progress that has actually been made in one element of Glasgow in relation to integration of health and social care? Sandra White mentioned a very specific example, I think, in relation to admission to care homes, in relation to qualifying for free personal care for the elderly. And I recognise the issue that Sandra White has raised there. But in terms of delayed discharge, actually, Glasgow has done very, very well in recent months. And actually, David Williams, who gave evidence to the Health and Sport Committee this morning, was talking about that. And he's the Chief Officer Designate for the Shadow Integration Board in Glasgow, and also the Head of Social Work for Glasgow City Council. So it actually shows that when there's a real focus and drive and determination on an integrated basis within the city, that we can actually get it right. Indeed, there are exceeding targets there in some cases. We need health and social care integration to similarly improve community health and social care, alleviate pressures on GPs, and see the development of integrated health and social care teams attentive to the needs of the community and shaped in a way that is meaningful to the integrated joint boards via locality planning, and GPs are central to that process. And I'm delighted to see QOF is going, and that's a significant achievement. However, what replaces it, the vacuum that is left, and those negotiations that are taking place, are just as important as the fact that that's going, and the new GP contract is indeed a real opportunity to direct funding as to where it's most needed. Will it allow us to focus on tackling health inequalities, particularly in our most deprived communities? Will the integrated joint boards be able to preferably via and a co-production model with GPs at the most local level, but able to shape a more localised model of GP provision and how that interacts with the wider health and social care integration within communities, whether it's community pharmacists, whether it's physiotherapists, whether it's speech and language therapists, whether it's care at home staff, whether it's OTs, whoever it may be, whether it's nurse specialists, whoever it may be, they have to be part of a combined health and social care team. And GPs have to have confidence in that combined health and social care team, irrespective of whether employed by GPs, by health centres, by the integrated joint boards or whoever. Because if they don't have confidence in those teams, they'll continue to refer directly to the acute sector. And that's part of the issue. We want GPs to have more tools in the box to refer to community disposals for health and social care needs. So actually, when people talk about there's not enough going on, there's a huge amount going on, and there's a huge amount of successes. And I've not actually dwelled in the successes within my speech, because I get the opposition would call that complacent. But there's significant structural change taking place, and the benefits are starting to emerge. And I'm glad there's been a significant degree of consensus within this debate, and I hope that continues going forward.
Many thanks. I call on Annette Millen to be followed by Mike McKenzie.
Thank you, Mr. Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to have been given the opportunity today to have some discussion around the way forward for primary care in Scotland. Throughout my time in Parliament, we've heard of an impending crisis within the NHS as more people are living longer, with many in their senior years coping with complex health problems. The Scottish Government's 2020 vision is what we all wish for, to be able to live for as long as possible at home or in a homely setting. Avoiding hospital admission and rest really require specialist inpatient care, and then returning into the community as soon as possible with the support services we need in place. But the system is currently creaking at the seams due to doctors retiring early, an ageing nursing workforce, young medical graduates unwilling to face the stresses of general practice, and difficulty in recruiting the good home carers so essential if the frail elderly are to sustain a reasonable quality of life within the community. I supported the 2004 GP contract because of the difficulty at that time in recruiting young doctors who weren't prepared to undertake the 24/7 on-call responsibilities of their predecessors. But that has run its course and recruitment has again fallen, this time because demands on the service are leaving GPs with too little time for face-to-face contact with the patients who really need their expertise, and a workload which is stressful and leading to a less than satisfactory work-life balance. Because of the undoubted challenges facing the system, it has been all too easy for opposing political parties to attack the government on health issues, which frankly, like Jackson Carlow, I don't think is good for either patients or the NHS staff, who in the vast majority of cases provide a tremendous service for patients, most of whom are very grateful for the care they receive. So I'm glad that there now seems to be some consensus developing on the way forward. The excellent report published recently by Sir Lewis Ritchie on out-of-hours care gives an in-depth analysis of the current situation and a comprehensive assessment of what is needed for a sustainable and, I quote, seamless service which not only meets the needs of patients but also offers a valued working and learning environment for all those delivering health and social care services, whether that be the NHS, local authority social services or the third sector. The thrust of the recommendations is that there's a need to develop multidisciplinary teams, including GPs, nurses, AHPs, community pharmacists, social care and other specialists, all working together to secure the best out-of-hours care for patients in urgent care resource hubs across Scotland. Sir Lewis's recommendations for out-of-hours care would sit very well with the daytime integrated health and social care service envisaged by most experts who have considered the issue. And the Scottish Government's plans to transform primary care services in light of the demands of an ageing population and as health and social care services are integrated. I look forward to the Government's detailed response to the out-of-hours report early next year and to how it proposes to implement this nationally. And I also look forward to hearing the detail of the new GMS contract currently being negotiated with the profession. And I am, of course, pleased that the Government has now announced the end of the QOF, which has undoubtedly outlived its usefulness. The future of primary care is clearly at a crossroads at the present time, and the BMA and others point the way forward by stating that the role of GPs and other primary care professionals must be to make the best use of the unique skills of each, with a proposal that GPs become more involved in complex care and system-wide activities, and the more routine tasks become more reliant on other health professionals in the wider community team. As senior decision makers, GPs would be seen as the expert generalists in their communities, able to support their local teams where their specific expertise is required. As emphasised by the BMA, the code of general practice expected by patients and the basis for learning the necessary skills has to be personal contact with patients who are or see themselves as unwell. But because of limited capacity, there will have to be a balance struck between access to GP appointments, access to other health professionals like nurses and community pharmacists, where that is more appropriate, and encouraging supported self-care, also where appropriate, and aided by the use of modern communication technology. For this to be acceptable to the public, effort will be needed to explain why these changes are required and how they will work. Practices would become the patient gateway to appropriate services overseen and managed by GPs to ensure that patients get the best care suited to their needs. For this to be effective, GPs must be at the core of health and social integration at locality level. Indeed, if they're not significantly involved and engaged with integration joint boards, then I, for one, cannot see integration being successful. And at the present time, I understand that this involvement is patchy across the country. It's never easy to change the way we work, and health and social care professionals come from different cultural backgrounds. They will need support to learn different ways of working together with mutual respect for each other as they seek the best outcomes for the patients in their care. This is already beginning to happen, and there are many good examples of professional cooperation, not least in my own region. For example, the NHS Grampian out-of-hours model employs a significant number of advanced nurse practitioners, all of whom are or are training to be independent prescribers, who work in the main centre in Aberdeen alongside GPs with team members from the Scottish Ambulance Service, community psychiatric and district nurses, Marie Curie nurses, and on-site pharmacy provision, and co-located with NHS 24. Different arrangements apply in the rural centres, where help is available from the main centre via video and telephone links. Presiding Officer, if primary care is once again to attract and retain young medical graduates, every indication is that we have to develop team working involving all health professionals, including nurses, AHPs and pharmacists, working together with social care and the third and independent sector.
If you could close, please.
If we can achieve this, and at the moment there's the will, but a long journey ahead, then I think we can build a sustainable system of good care in our communities. I think we're on the cusp of some very exciting developments in primary care. I'm just sorry I won't be in Parliament when they come to fruition. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now call on Mike McKenzie to be followed by Neil Findlay. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this important debate, and I know from the opposition party amendments that the core of their argument seems to be about the allocation of resources. They want more resources allocated to primary care. I agree with them. It would be good to allocate more resources to primary care. It would be good to allocate more resources to healthcare in general. In fact, it would be good to allocate more resources to every aspect of expenditure devolved to this Parliament. And that's why I opposed and will continue to oppose the economically illiterate austerity policies of the opposition parties. The fact of the matter, however, is that we're living in an era of austerity. We saw austerity under the previous coalition government in Westminster, and now that the spending review has been published, we are seeing yet more austerity going on into the future. And, Presiding Officer, you might say that's what the people voted for. That's what they voted for in the recent Westminster election. That is their democratic choice. And that is indeed what the people of the UK voted for. But it is not what the people of Scotland voted for. Overwhelmingly, the people of Scotland rejected austerity. No, thank you. And yet, thanks to this democratic deficit within our constitutional arrangements, no, thank you, Smith or no Smith, Scotland Act or no Scotland Act, we are stuck with austerity. And I remember, too, in the last Scottish election, the SNP, this SNP, government made a manifesto commitment to ring-fence health spending, something that Labour, the main opposition party, refused to do. That's what SNP committed to do in this Parliament, and that is what we've done. The Labour Party refused to commit to ring-fencing the health budget, but neither did
point
they
promise
to increase
Jackson, it. Carlow.
I wonder, Presiding Officer, if the member intends to address himself to the terms of the motions that are before us for debate this afternoon.
As Mr Carlow will know, that's not a point of order, but the point has been made, Mr McKenzie.
And noting that, Presiding Officer, I would urge patience when all will become clear. The Labour Party refused to commit to ring-fencing the health budget. Neither did they promise to increase it. The Labour Party amendment is therefore disingenuous. With regard to primary health care, there are very good arguments that can be made for increasing resources. No, thank you. There are also good arguments that can be made to increase funding for every other aspect of health care. But what the opposition members fail to do, as they always do, is to say where the cuts will fall to fund an increased allocation of resources to primary care. No, thank you. Against this background, perhaps later, but not just now. Against this background, Presiding Officer, this background of austerity, this background of falling public budgets, this background of cuts to our block grant, I am pleased and I am proud that this government has maintained health spending. I am pleased that it's been possible to increase primary care spending by almost £80 million. I am pleased that we've recently announced a further £60 million for the Primary Care Development Fund. I am pleased that the number of GPs in Scotland is at an all-time high. I am pleased that we are increasing training places for GPs from 300 to 400 a year from next year. I am pleased that we already have fewer patients per GP than either England or Wales. I think Sandra White touched on that fact. I am pleased that the Scottish Government has announced that it will work with the BMA to dismantle the quality and outcomes framework system of GP payments, reducing that bureaucratic burden on all of our GPs. And I am pleased that the Scottish Government has recognised the teamwork approach to the delivery of primary care. And I am pleased that the vital role played by nurses and community pharmacists and physiotherapists is increasingly being recognised by the Scottish Government. No, thank you. Presiding Officer, primary health care is important. Health care is important. But as we increasingly move to patient-centred delivery of health care, it's important to realise that the patient too has a role to play in this, in playing their part in remaining healthy, in maintaining healthy, active lifestyles. And we're fortunate in terms of healthcare to be living in the 21st century. Looking back, many of the big improvements in public health outcomes have been made by improving lifestyles and the environment in which we live. Public water and sanitation systems delivered, for instance, huge improvements in health. And that's why we must maintain our momentum on drives to reduce smoking and improve our relationship with alcohol and to encourage active lifestyles. But most of all, Presiding Officer, we must recognise that the biggest current threat to better public health outcomes is rising inequality. We must renew our fight against austerity, which inevitably, with cuts falling as always on the shoulders of those least able to bear them, has the effect of increasing inequality and increasing all the health problems that go along with it.
Thank you very much. That's excellent. Now call on Neil Findlay to be followed by Stuart Stevenson. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Presiding Officer, I'm pleased that Mr McKenzie's speech only lasted 6 minutes and we didn't have to listen to another second of it. I was going to say it's a pleasure to follow Mr McKenzie, but I'd be lying, so I won't. Can I say that appeals by some not to make the NHS political? I mean, I have to say to some people, get real.
The fact that we have a socialised healthcare system funded via taxation is hugely political in itself, and it always will be. So for politicians to say health shouldn't be political is at best naive and at worst downright stupid. Try telling that to the people in America who've been tearing each other apart over the future of their healthcare system, and it is a hugely political issue and always will be. But the backbone of our healthcare system is the dedicated and committed staff on the front line. And I think we all recognise, many people have said it today, that recognise we owe a tremendous debt to social care workers, community nurses, midwives, community psychiatric nurses, AHPs and our GPs. These are the folk who hold the system together, and without them, our hospitals would be even more full and more pressured than they are at present. But these people don't want patronising warm words. They want action. But, Presiding Officer, the very same people are coming under pressure like never, ever before. The ageing population, multiple complex needs of patients combined with a crisis in GP recruitment and cuts to student numbers have created the perfect storm. In my own area, the clinical director of the West Lothian Health and Social Care Partnership has said, and I quote, "There is a serious nationwide crisis in general practice." I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary agrees with that statement. Maybe in her summing up, she can address whether she does believe that there is a crisis, and that is the word I would like her to address in her summing up, if there's a crisis in general practice. A system that is working well should see sufficient numbers of GPs, nurses, home care staff, all working seamlessly, taking actions to ensure that people are treated appropriately and in the right place. If someone can be treated at home with the right care package put in to support them, that takes pressure off the GP surgery and allows the doctor to address more pressing and complex cases. This is part of the solution in the report by Dr. Ritchie. And I would like to see all of that go a step further. It kind of matches the approach that we have taken in West Lothian for many years, where different services coming together in partnership centres. So we have, for example, GP practices, dentists, pharmacy, sport and leisure facilities, Job Centre Plus, library, all housing office, all coming together in new, modern, state-of-the-art buildings, providing services cross-referring to each other to address the needs of local people. That's the vision, I think, that we should have for our public services, and all of that working together will improve the health and well-being of people. But too often, staff shortages of one kind or another prevent this from happening. I spoke to one practice last year which was operating in one of the poorest communities in Scotland. It had gone for a whole year without a health visitor. A whole year. That to me is almost criminal, and I don't believe it would have happened in another community with possibly a different socio-economic profile. Over the last few years, I've spoken to doctor after doctor in my region, and they have either contacted me and requested to speak to me, or I have contacted them because of problems experienced by patients who've contacted for assistance. And these doctors have been only too willing to speak, raising their concerns, and I thank them very much for their candour. Only this past year, we've seen 42 practices taken under control of NHS boards as practices buckle under pressure. Last year in Lothian, I think the count was one in six practices having some sort of restriction on taking in new patients, some of them with lists completely closed. Local residents forced to go elsewhere to access a GP in areas, and that is in an area where population is increasing significantly, and it's going to get worse, especially as more than a quarter of GPs are within 5 years or less of retiring. So we see increasing caseloads in GPs, certainly.
Dr. Richard Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Just to update you on the restricted practice element, figures I've received today from Lothian, 32 out of 125 practices are now operating restrictions. So that's a quarter of all practices in Lothian.
Your remaining 45 seconds, please.
Thanks very much for that. That shows the extent of the problem. A decade ago, when practices, where a GP was retiring, practices would have a healthy list of people wanting to take on that partnership. Now, in practices, many of them have zero applicants. If they're lucky enough to secure locum cover, they think they've won the lottery and cling on to that locum-like Olympic. Doctors tell me of them coming into work early, working late, working through lunch breaks, taking work home, working on their days off, just to stand still. So the reduction in bureaucracy, I think, will be warmly welcome because many are at breaking point. And for patients, it's getting worse too. All sorts of systems are operating in surgeries to try and address pressures. We have doctors operating like a supermarket butcher's, where you take a ticket and you sit as long as you have to until you're called.
Draw to a close, please.
And we have others who are now assessing people on the phone. Now, I think that may be necessary in order to deal with a short-term problem. But what we could end up with is that situation being embedded in our system. And I don't think that would be acceptable. Time is tight, Presiding Officer. I'll finish there.
Thanks very much. Now call on Stuart Stevenson to be followed by Duncan McNeill.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I note that I'm almost certainly the third speaker in this debate whose naissance predates, of course, the founding of the Health Service. And it's always as well to, when you're talking about redesigning primary care, to think about the process of change there's been. Family tree research is one of my interests. I see death certificates very regularly from the 1880s, even the 1890s, where it simply says on cause of death, old age, senility, decline, decay, no medical attendant. So access to medical advice and to doctors is something that has come in relatively recently. Lloyd George, of course, in 1908 set in process the Act that ended up as the 1911 National Insurance Act, which meant there was a little contribution taken from each wage packet to pay for health care. And indeed, to this day, my records and many other people's are still kept in these medical folders, which some of the older GPs still call Lloyd George's, because that's when they were introduced. The Highland Health Service in the 1930s set the pattern for much of the health service. But, of course, post-war, the Labour government, probably their greatest achievement post-war, established universal health care free at the point of supply. And my father was a GP in that service, retiring in his 70s in the 1970s. The world has changed dramatically since he was a doctor. Now that's the really interesting point. In those days, we only had doctors, hospitals, nurses, dentists, chemists and opticians. We didn't have urgent care centres, primary care, emergency centres, community unscheduled care, nurses, and a whole plethora of definitions, which whenever the patient is exposed to them, they're confused. The world would be rather better, I think, and care would be better if we simply had simple titles for that we use with people. And I think I refer to page 64 in the report that we have before us that says knowledge of who to turn to, what to do in the event of feeling unwell when the doctor's surgery is closed and which service to turn to first. There is considerable confusion because of the complexity that is presented to patients. And perhaps while we need complexity under the surface to deliver the care service, we should look at a little simplicity in how we deliver it and talk to patients about our health service. When my father was a doctor, it was incredibly easy. You just needed to know one telephone number, which was Cooper 3182. And as luck would have it, the Cottage Hospital was Cooper 3128. So if you got the numbers muddled up, you got one or the other. And that was just OK. The world was, of course, very different in all sorts of ways. My father used to write his prescriptions in Latin, so it was tres in diem rather than three times a day. And, of course, the quantities were written in Greek in minims, so you had perhaps deca minims of whatever it was. Fortunately, the pharmacist also spoke Greek. He was a rural doctor, and to this day, rural issues remain a key problem for the health service. I'm fortunate not to know the name of my GP because I have no contact with that person. But I know that in rural areas, often distant from their patients, often isolated from the kind of help that many doctors in urban areas have, we've got to look further out at that. Now, out-of-hours provision, which is something that's been referred to on a recurring basis throughout the debate here, is a more complex thing for the patient. I've actually only, in reading the material for this debate, discovered that NHS 24 is 111. That's what you phone. I didn't know that. Never had to do it. Never had to consider what the number was. I would have previously just looked up my doctor's number in the phone book, but at least I now know that. Out of hours is, of course, the area of the health service with the lowest satisfaction rating. Perhaps that's not too surprising because, of course, when you want out-of-hours care, that is related to a crisis in your personal health, a point where you're less likely to be tolerant, more likely to be critical. You feel that sense of urgency. Now, technology is, of course, helping doctors and helping patients. Nowadays, the health service is asking us all to do some of the health checks. I've just completed one of the regular health checks for those of us of my age and all clear again, and that's good news. My watch can tell me what my heartbeat is, and I know that I did that just before this debate. It was sitting pretty well where it should be, and the data is already being stored in a server in California, so it could be available to others. But, of course, one of the things that's said in the report is that information about people's health history is not broadly available. Perhaps we should do something very, very simple. Just take all the handwritten notes and scan them in. We're sort of focusing on these difficult things of translating them into words and interpreting them. There are things we perhaps ought to do. But, Presiding Officer, in the last 10 seconds that you might grant me, I think we're doing very well. The quality of care compared to 50 years ago and when I was born is incomparably better. We can always do better. As us old wrinklies get older, we will demand more. That's inescapable. It's just one of the challenges we're going to have to rise to. Presiding Officer.
Thanks so much. Now call on Duncan McNeill to be followed by Alison Johnson.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I welcome this debate today. The second debate, I think, you know, in recent times are out with legislation. So, you know, the more of it, the better. We I think, had been described on a journey of health and social care integration and, of course, redesigning of our primary care as part of that journey. And as Bob Doris rightly says, there's a lot going on. Maybe the frustration, not the capping from the sidelines that has been put mildly by Jackson in terms of the concerns about the lack of progress. I think we all are concerned about the lack of progress. Certainly Audit Scotland is concerned and identified risk about lack of progress in health and social care integration. They've identified risks in government and accountability, budgets, strategic plans, and indeed the workforce. And while the government, I think, can draw confidence from the fact that anybody who has been interested in this debate, in the committees and in this parliament, the government have the confidence of this parliament that all of the challenges that we face, the demographic challenge that we face, complicated by long-standing health inequalities, where people are living longer but with more complex conditions and ill health, not brought about by recent austerity, but our failure to deal with that over a period of time. And indeed, as Campbell Christie once said, we had lots of money during the term of this Parliament, and we didn't deal with some of these issues. So it isn't simply money, of course it isn't. We're dealing with a workforce challenge. We face a significant challenge there currently in terms of how we're spending money on locums and temporary workforce and all of these things, which are not good use of the finances we have. We better spend in preventative areas. I think we are concerned that at this stage, the health workforce of the future, that workforce that is going to work in the community, deliver health and care from home, has not even been visualised yet. There's no real discussion that this Parliament's aware of about what that workforce will look like in the future. And, of course, the financial challenge. And of course, that is ever-present. It would have been great, I think. We couldn't have picked a worse time to be on this journey. There was a time when this Parliament had more money only, if only we had been wiser in its use. And there's a cultural challenge. There are those people who find change difficult, whether they're professional people or whether they're care workers. They find change work. The suggestion that they may have to work in a different area, the suggestion that they may have to avail themselves to new education and new experiences and new training. That they may have to work out of the building that they've been working in for 30 years. This is challenging for people. So nobody should underestimate that we are not aware of the challenges. In fact, it's quite interesting, actually, that we're celebrating a no-brainer. That people who work to provide our care and health services should work together. Revolutionary stuff. They should work together using all of the skills to the maximum of their licence to ensure that our health service continues to provide the quality service. Now, what's revolutionary about that? But underlying all that, there is difficult cultural changes. We shouldn't dismiss it easily, but it is. So the government has got to have confidence that this Parliament support them in this journey. And those who are expected to make those changes must have the confidence that they will be supported to make that change, that the appropriate investment will be placed where it needs to be placed and will be supported within that service to make that change. And of course, GPs are central to that role, but they're not solely GPs. And I think that they need to be confident or will not reach the objective of emergency out-of-hours redesign. If GPs are not confident that we have highly skilled care workers, social workers, who are delivering quality services in our community, they will not refer those patients they meet out-of-hours to the community. So they all stand together, and unless we can give them the confidence that the decisions that they will make in terms of people's care will be satisfied within the community, then they will not do it. And we have a big problem in that in recent years, while we've been protecting the health budget, we have not been protecting the local government budgets, and they are inheriting a workforce that in some cases is demoralised, unchained and poorly paid, and that needs to change. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McNeill. Now call on Alison Johnson to be followed by Richard Lyle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that we're debating this important issue this afternoon. It is so important that all people in Scotland have the means and services to enable them to enjoy optimal health and a properly resourced health service that is there for them when they need it. Because without health and well-being, it's difficult to make the most of life's opportunities. And we know only too well the impact of inequality on health. So it really is essential that we do all we can to make sure that everyone in Scotland has access to a GP when they need one. Yet this access, as we've heard, is becoming more of a challenge than ever before. This year, here in Lothian, practices in Rathaw and Bangham have struggled to provide primary care to patients. At the time, a constituent who lives in Rathaw Village wrote and told of the extraordinary position that people living in Rathaw Village found themselves in, where we'll have no doctor in the surgery for the next week, and they'd only had a doctor for 2 days a week for the 6 weeks beforehand. Now, my constituent advised that he'd been offered an alternative surgery in Leith. That's a journey of around 10 miles one way. So in terms of cost and travel time, not to mention time off work or school, it's difficult to imagine a less convenient option. And like many people, he wants to understand the events and circumstances that led to this situation, and he asks that the local health board provide an explanation of where systems and planning have led to this situation. He asks, why has this happened? So he used the word extraordinary, and that's because the lack of access to a GP is unexpected, it is unusual, and clearly it's extremely worrying. But there are many reasons why this has happened, and also I'm pleased to say there are solutions. But we have moved from a position where competition for GP positions was intense, with several applicants for each post, to the situation reported in MSP meetings with NHS Lothian, where interview dates have been cancelled due to lack of interest or due to lack of candidates for an advertised post. And, of course, as GP vacancies increase, the burden on existing staff increases, adding to workloads that the BMA describe as already unsustainable. They tell us, too, that morale amongst GPs is at an all-time low, that more GPs than ever before are leaving mid-career, and senior GPs are retiring early. Now, I know one such GP who told me recently that the bureaucracy he was dealing with meant he simply couldn't do the job he'd been doing previously, the job he wanted to do, needed to do, and unfortunately he felt he couldn't carry on. And he worked in a practice in an area with many social challenges, and the loss of his skill, passion and experience will have a negative impact. And I am very pleased that the burden that is QOF is being removed. Presiding Officer, we've heard too that there are practices with restrictions on their lists. For example, potential patients may only be able to register on certain days of the week. And lack of access to primary care can often result in patients seeking assistance in hospital, sometimes heading straight to accident or emergency, or having been unable to access primary care, an initially non-serious illness has become more acute and requires that attention in hospital. Now, I welcome the government's commitment to address this issue and the ongoing work to agree a new GP contract from 2017, because it is clear that action is required. And it's really important that we listen to and work with the profession to ensure that we get the change right. The Royal College of General Practitioners, the BMA and the Royal College of Emergency Medicine have worked hard engaging with government and parliamentarians. Martin McKechnie, the Vice President of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, asks us to invest in GP training and retention in order to see fewer patients heading to A&E for care. He does credit the government with increasing consultant numbers and asks that even more is done so that every hospital in Scotland can provide a 365 days a year service. He highlights the loss of graduate emergency registrars, a lot of them to Australia. And the RCGP tells us that many qualified GPs too are leaving to practice abroad and that there are insufficient numbers undertaking GP specialty training. The Royal College of General Physicians has told us that GPs want to look after their patients and not the books. They want to see a more appropriate replacement evolving for QOF, one that works for patients and GPs. And the BMA asks us to recruit, retain and value doctors and asks that all parties in this Parliament work with them to support Scottish general practice. We need to make being a GP in Scotland a really attractive career opportunity that attracts people in the way it did previously, one to which GPs taking a break will return. And I really do hope that the current work on agreeing this new contract will take these factors and more into account. GP practices have worked on a small business model since the 60s. Now, that may be the preference of many practices, but more and more GPs don't want to be partners, don't want to be full-time. They may prefer being employed by the NHS or by the practice. And new models and changing contracts can make being a GP a more attractive career to a greater number of people. Presiding officer, working and listening to and with health professionals in this country gives us the real possibility of developing and delivering a healthcare model that will better support those working in the NHS, helping them to keep our growing and ageing population well. Sir Lewis Ritchie's out-of-hours model makes much sense, fully involving a whole range of allied professionals in primary care in a way that we haven't today, in a transformative way. And this will have positive impacts too for in-hours care. And just as I finish, it's clearly very important that at the forefront of all debates on health, we focus on the need for preventative ill health. And I think the BMA's suggestion of a portion of fruit or vegetables for all primary school children in Scotland is one that's well worth looking at, as is a living wage. Thank you.
Thank you. Now call on Richard Lyle, after which we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by commending the good work of dedicated health and care professionals in Scotland who provide a vital service to ensure that the people of Scotland are healthy and receive the best care possible. Effective frontline community health care is vital to helping people enjoy life at home or in a homely setting for as long as possible. However, we do currently face the challenge of recruiting and retaining general practitioners, GPs, and need to address that problem to make sure that the people of Scotland do receive all the care they need. I support the current work to agree a new GP contract from Scotland for 2017, which will see bureaucracy reduced for GPs, hopefully, to give them more time with their patients and present the opportunity to go even further to tackle health inequalities in communities. I'd now like to talk about the integration of health and social care that is currently underway in North Lanarkshire. Integration is about local teams of professionals working together alongside partners, including unpaid carers, the third sector, and independent sector, to deliver quality, sustainable care and services. The focus of integration is on ensuring people get it right, get the right advice, support in the right place and at the right time. Yesterday, a new timeline was published with key plans for how integration will be delivered in local areas. North Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership is striving to ensure that the process is as understandable as possible. The aim of the timeline is to bring further clarity around the integration process. Janice Hewitt, Chief Accountable Officer of North Lanarkshire Health and Social Care Partnership, said that the overall vision of integration is to make sure that the citizens of North Lanarkshire achieve their full potential through living safe, healthy and independent lives in their communities. She adds, we also want people to receive the information, advice, support or care they need at the right time, every time, efficiently and effectively. I hope this example from North Lanarkshire sheds some light on how integrated health and social care at a community level can be achieved, and I applaud the work of everyone in North Lanarkshire who has made this integration possible. Previously, as a councillor, I dealt with many patients who unfortunately could not get out of hospital on the day of their release due to the fact that nothing was in place at their home. I also dealt with the fact that both the hospital and the social work were blaming each other for the delay. I'm sure that with this new integration, that these problems will be resolved finally. I now turn my comments to out-of-hours service. As many people may or may not know, from Monday to Thursday, an ordinary week out-of-hours comes into play, 6 p.m. to 8 a.m. the next day. Then comes into play on a Friday at 6 p.m. straight through the weekend to a Monday morning at 8 a.m. That work that out-of-hours staff, doctors and drivers often goes unnoticed. As I've previously stated in this chamber, I had the experience and the honour of working part-time as a driver for out-of-hours for over 2 years prior to coming to this place. I saw for myself the hard work done by all staff who worked for out-of-hours. All staff were well-trained in customer services and dedicated to that service. Presiding officer, next week we will see our out-of-hours service put to the Christmas test once again. During the 2 years that I worked there, I, for the first time in my working life ever, worked the festive period, Christmas Eve, Christmas Day and Boxing Day. It certainly wasn't as quiet as what a lot of people think. It was actually very busy. Driving, conveying patients to their appointment was certainly an eye-opener. I saw for myself what the staff in our NHS have to cope with, and even after 4.5 years on, I'm sure it have got busier in the time that I've been away. When GP surgeries close next week, A&E and out-of-hours will come more into play. During the one-year period, 1st of May 2014 to 30 April 2015, almost 1 million contacts were made with primary care out-of-hours services. NHS 24 dealt with 1.3 million calls, and I want to compliment NHS 24 on the work that they do in triaging and arranging appointments for patients. They are the front line. In that period, I also mentioned A&E also coped with over 900,000 emergency department attendances. Also, Scottish Ambulance Service dealt with 500,999 in general practice urgency calls. The annual cost of delivering primary out-of-hours care reported by Scotland's NHS boards in 2014-15 was £81.8 million. NHS 24 incurred costs of £40.4 million. That totals to £122.2 million. I also want to highlight that staff working both in hospitals and out of hours deal with many difficult pressures, particularly delivering care during unsociable hours and through the night. Some staff work in isolated areas. I've also been in areas of hospitals where the only people that were there was a doctor from out of hours in the consulting room, myself in the waiting room, along with patients. I would suggest that this is why some doctors don't want to work out of hours due to safety concerns, but I know that these concerns are being addressed. Presiding Officer, I will finish my speech by thanking all who work in our health service. I wish them well over the coming festive period. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year to all. They look after Scotland's health and they deserve all our support all year round. Thank you.
Many thanks. And we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Jim Hume.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think we've had a good debate in most parts. There's agreement from across the chamber that we need to act and act urgently on primary care. That's encouraging. We, of course, have different views on how and on what the progress is to date. But I think we do agree that change is needed. And we need to see action from whatever government, as Bob Doris said, we do have. We heard from one SNP member, can't remember his name exactly, who mentioned austerity and what they would be able to do if they had cuts. I would doubt if I'd be able to take an intervention from someone who wouldn't take any intervention myself, but actually failed to mention the £347 million reported by Audit Scotland that was unspent by the Scottish Government in the last year, so they can't really use that old, out-of-date excuse. So GP numbers are already fewer than they should be. Just today we saw newly released information that average GP practice list sizes have increased by 10% since 2007. The government has simply not done enough at this point to avert a crisis. So we're already seeing practices not accepting new patients on their lists. The Cabinet Secretary herself acknowledges that, and I quote from her that there is an increasing awareness of practices facing sustainability challenges across Scotland. So with more than a third of GPs set to retire within the next decade, the midpoint for recruiting these exiting the profession is about 740. But to further guarantee that general practice is sustainable, we are looking at probably an approximation of 915 GPs needed. So the government does need to plan for the changes in demographics, both in GPs and, of course, the population. A point that I think was made by many members today. The announcement of dismantling the quality outcomes framework for GP practices, I think, is a welcome step forward. This will allow GPs to spend more time with their patients. It's a step in the direction that we have wanted on these benches to move in for a long time, to allow doctors to do their jobs and put professionalism back in the profession. But this still leaves unaddressed the role that general practice and primary healthcare professionals will play in the integration plans this coming April. And with only a few months to go, and the last I heard, only 6 of the 31 integration areas have their plans agreed. So that is worrying, but we all wish for that to be a success, of course. Professionals in the primary care services need to have reassurances, and they need to have proof of these reassurances. The Royal College of Nursing provides helpful recommendations on how to better redesign primary care. Nurses are already a vital part of primary care teams, delivering services in hours and out of hours settings. They'll naturally be affected by the GP contract changes, but we can take this opportunity to bring out radical changes that empower nurses' roles and make the most of their vast knowledge and skills. There are, of course, advanced nurse practitioners whose role can be very beneficial to the whole community, working alongside other health professionals. It's also the great benefit they offer of freeing up time for other medical professionals to focus more time on patients. And district nurses in some remote areas are the only providers of face-to-face health care. So, but while we're looking at using this resource, we must keep in mind the worrying trend of increasing nursing and midwifery vacancies. There are now over 2,400 vacancies for nurses and midwives, and 500 of these have been unfilled for more than 3 months. So the RCN continues to warn about the unsustainable vacancy levels, and we must listen to that. And last week, the NHS staff survey showed that 75% of nurses say there isn't enough staff for them to do their jobs properly. Overworked staff is clearly the last thing we want to see, not just for patient safety, but also for the well-being of the already hard-working NHS staff. However, Deputy Presiding Officer, almost 90% of the staff in the survey are willing and happy to go that extra mile at work when required, something which shows the first priority of health professionals is, of course, patient care. What the Scottish Government has to do is to recognise their importance and support them, of course, to do their jobs. The Ritchie report should offer the guidance and what steps should be followed. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, while it's welcome that the Scottish Government put forth this debate, there's no point in having it if it refuses to face the facts and rejects realities on the ground. NHS staff, left and right, are warning us that the NHS is becoming unsustainable. Nurses, GPs and pharmacists note that embracing and utilising the skills and clinical expertise of staff can provide innovation. Making the NHS a good place to working and be treated at doesn't only take considerable financial investment, where such investment is necessary, but also smart and practical guidance. NHS staff is the most important asset in the NHS itself. As Liberal Democrats want to see that any recruitment problems are preempted and, of course, prevented. So when the Scottish Government want to talk about redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities, it should start with redesigning its own approach as to how best serve the needs of staff working in our communities. So, Deputy Presiding Officer, in concluding, there's critical need to align spending on health services with clinical need and the level of the capacity. That is what health and social integration requires, putting primary care in the centre of it. We need to do that by firstly recognising the risk to GP services, recognising that health inequalities are a national disgrace, and we need to address recruitment across the board in the NHS, and in particular in announcing an extra 100 GP training positions isn't enough. It means nothing when we can only fill 237 of the 300 positions at this moment. We need to recognise the importance of GPs, a key part of delivering healthcare in Scotland, and the Liberal Democrats shall strive to ensure that Scotland has a robust NHS for generations to come. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Now, Colin Jackson-Carlow. 6 minutes, please, Mr. Carlow.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, you know, there was almost the first whiff of nostalgia this afternoon, I felt, as we came to the end of the year with just 11 weeks of this, working weeks of this Parliament left. We heard from three of the self-appointed Cheerio Squad on the Labour benches, from Drew Smith, from Duncan McNeill and from Richard Simpson, all of whom will be leaving us at the end of this term voluntarily. We heard from my colleague Nanette Milne, who is also retiring. We heard twice from Jim Hume, who the electorate of the South of Scotland will show good sense and retire. And we had possibly the most bizarre contribution of the afternoon from Mr. McKenzie. Now, Mr. McKenzie is not known to us in these health debates. I don't think he's really a regular participator, as far as I can recall. Clearly, High Command decided that a vital contribution from him was needed this afternoon. And I was reminded of my old maths teacher who used to look at my homework and say, bilge, supreme bilge, because that was the best that could be said of Mr. McKenzie's contribution. Mr McKenzie ignored the fact that his own former colleague, the former Cabinet Secretary for Health, Alec Neil, in response to a written question, confirmed that the health service in Scotland had received an additional £1.3 billion in consequentials arising from increased health spending at Westminster during the lifetime of this Parliament. No cut from Westminster, Mr McKenzie, on health. No austerity on health. And during the course of the next 5 years, by the end of it, we should be seeing an additional £800 million annually for the health service in Scotland. Now, that in itself is not the solution to the crisis. No, I'm trying to help you, not hinder you any further. Mr Stevenson interjected, and I was getting worried, Mr Stevenson, because I thought you were traducing the reputation of your family somewhat when you concluded by saying that healthcare was incomparably better now than it was when your father was a GP. And I'm sure that wasn't meant to be a personal observation, but I'll take it at face value. We came in the debate, though, I think, broadly to a consensus about the fact that primary care is the key area of health, the health service, that needs attention, needs investment, and needs leadership. And I think it was Nigel Dawn who touched on the concept of leadership, because we discussed this last week in the integrated joint boards, that we talk about leadership as if it's something that grows on trees. It's actually a very difficult thing to nurture and to have within something as huge and complicated as the NHS. But so much of what we are looking to achieve will require political leadership as well as leadership within the health boards. Now, I think we need to educate the public. I wonder whether when young people come of age, having been in the health service since birth, there shouldn't perhaps even within the curriculum be a proper session that educates them as to what they can expect from the health service, but also of their own responsibilities to their own healthcare as they go through life. Should we not, as I said earlier, be ensuring that households have a proper annual statement that directs them correctly within their health board region as to where the services they need to access are? We assume so many people understand and know, and very often they do not. We talk about multidisciplinary teams operating within potential GP hub facilities, but I wonder if the public know what we mean when we talk about multidisciplinary teams. We need to ensure that first responders are encouraged. Conservatives believe that we also need to look very carefully, and we make no apology for repeating again, at GP-attached health visiting teams on a universal service across Scotland, with additional concentration in areas as Drew Smith and as... I've forgotten his name now, the fellow at the back. Anyhow...
Neil Findlay.
Dr. Findlay indicated, with a concentration of that resource in areas of higher inequality, because as well as providing a second-to-none GP healthcare service, we also need to use it to assist in the reduction in inequalities. Now, the realities are, however, within Lewis Ritchie's report, that we are looking to a potential shortfall by 2020 in the number of GPs we have. That is a real challenge to make that service one that attracts new recruits into it. We know that there are a considerable number set to retire in the next 5 years. We know, and I don't mean this in any sense as being a cut, but the increase in overall health spending has nonetheless masked a reduction of the percentage of that has gone into primary care from 9.5% down to about 7.5%. And I think we do need to see that reversed if what we are seeing is going to be given effect and meaning. The health service funding issues, of course, would be resolved completely if we had £1,000 for every time Mr Dorris said, I want to put this on the record, because I know that is his favourite phrase, and it's repeated so regularly that it could save the finances of the NHS. But I believe that as a result of the debate that's taken place this afternoon, there's an understanding from all parties that this is the principal challenge of the next Parliament. It's not that other areas of the health service don't need attention too, but we need to get GP primary care services right for the future, because, you know, we talked about 2020 in our vision for the health service, and for a while it always seemed like something like 2001, A Space Odyssey, way off in the future. It's 4 years away. We're very close to already being in 2020, and we still have a lot of work to do to have a health service and a primary care health service which will succeed in face of the challenges ahead.
Many thanks. Now Colin Rhoda Grant. 8 minutes, please, Ms Grant.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I begin by paying tribute to the staff. Our people are the most valuable asset we have, those who work in the NHS and also those who work in local government providing health and social care. We need to tell them that they're valued, but we also need to go further and we need to show them that they're valued. If we don't give them the right support, if we ignore the needs of health and community care, we don't show them that value. We must stop creating boundaries between health care and community care. We must give them parity of respect and esteem. I think we agree that people should live independently for as long as possible at home, and if that's not possible, they should be in a homely setting. Regardless of where they are, they should receive high-quality care. However, primary care and social care have been underfunded, while we concentrate on the funding of acute care. Mental health and learning disabilities have also moved out of the hospital into the community without adequate resource transfer. And this is the unintended consequence of increasing pressure on acute care as people reach crisis with no cheaper or easier intervention in the community. We need to redesign services to stop this happening. Margaret McCullough said 90% of health care happens in primary care and only 10% in acute care. We need to redesign our own culture of giving greater esteem to acute care to make this change. We called for a full-scale review back in 2011, a Beveridge 21, as Richard Simpson said, to create a health service fit for the 21st century. We were made aware of problems in the NHS by our constituents. Some of them were patients, some of them were staff. All had concerns about the direction of travel and indeed the impending disaster. The Scottish Government rejected these calls, saying they knew what was wrong, they knew how to fix it, and a review would have taken too long. Had it started in 2011, it would have been finished by now. But instead, they have come belatedly to realise the scale of the problem, and some 4 years later have called for a national conversation. In the meantime, we had already set up two commissions, one on health inequalities and one on social care. They have now reported. And if Jackson Carlow thinks that's yad, 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 I would have to say, sadly, it's the truth. We brought concerns in good faith. Consensus politics works in both directions. We had genuine concerns, and we wanted to instigate change and improvement, and yet it was being dismissed as carping from the sidelines. Respect works both ways, and I see raising our constituents' concerns, not as being partisan. I believe it is our duty. And that's why I welcome the change of tone from the Cabinet Secretary today. I will join her in her fitting tribute to Richard Simpson. We're all going to miss his wise counsel and his knowledge of the health service. But the fact that she also met with him to discuss his paper, it's detailed, it's thought through, it has positive solutions and ideas, and I believe that shows a change of heart, and I hope that she will give it the attention it requires, and I think it will show a way forward, certainly within general practice, which is in crisis, as other members have said, Neil Findlay, Alison Johnston, and indeed others. We need to solve the crisis in general practice if we're going to deal with primary care. A number of speakers also spoke about health inequalities. Drew Smith talked about investment in preventative care, but also the imbalance of resources in the most deprived area where they were most required. And we've heard deep-end GPs talk about the inverse care law before. The more the need in an area, the less of the funding that goes. They receive more calls, more need for appointments, but less funding. And he also made the point, and I think it's something we often miss when we talk about the inverse care law. In a way, it's those who shout the loudest get the service. But it's also about the low expectation of those people who live in deprived communities. They have been taught over a lifetime not to expect very much. And because they have that low expectation, they don't call out for services. And I think we need to change not only the service that we give them, possibly throughout their lives, to build that expectation, but we need to make sure that they get fair access to services, especially when they become unwell. And Duncan McNeill talked about demographics, and again, that impacts on health inequalities, because we have an ageing population, and that is good. You know, people getting older, living longer, longer healthy lives is what we want. Unfortunately, in deprived areas, those lives are shorter, but the amount of the proportion of those lives spent in poor health is longer in comparison. And that's surely wrong. We need to do something about it. We need to invest in community care to relieve some of the pressure on GPs, as Neil Finlay said. And I think it's very important that community care fills this gap, not only for GPs, but also in acute care. Richard Lyle talked about bed blocking. Bed blocking happens because there is not the services in the community to either stop people going into hospital in the first place, or indeed to allow them to get home when they end up in hospital. And I think a number of speakers talked about Sir Lewis Ritchie's report and, you know, the impact this could make. He speaks about the things we know are required, things like resource hubs that keep people at home, joint working multidisciplinary teams, as Duncan McNeill said, revolutionary, people working together. Surely this is almost a no-brainer, and it's a bit sad that we need a report to tell us what's staring us in the face. He also said Duncan McNeill also said that GPs need to have confidence in those solutions within the community, because if they don't, they will continue to refer people into acute care because they're afraid of the alternative about keeping them at home. We need to look at new models of care, and a number of members spoke about models in their own constituencies, and I'll just mention one in mine. In Skye, Macmillan and Boots the chemist have worked together looking at palliative care, working with care homes, working with GPs who are looking after patients at home, making sure that medications are right, that the right interventions are found in time, and that there is really quick intervention. Now, that has saved a huge amount of money, but more than that, it has provided really good quality patient care, and I think that's what we should all be striving for. A number of people talked about training and staffing, and indeed the decrease in training that has gone on over the last few years. Audit Scotland, in their report about integration, talked about the staffing profile for joint working and said that the staffing profile is set by past cuts rather than current need, and that is something that needs to be addressed very, very quickly if integration is going to work. Presiding Officer, we welcome the debate. We really need a step change on how health is delivered. We know we need to move to preventative and indeed community care, and we've known about that for some years, but we're still talking about it. There is consensus, we need a strategy, and we need delivery.
Many thanks. And we now move to the closing speech from the Cabinet Secretary, Shona Robison. You have 10 minutes and until 5 o'clock, please.
Okay, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I welcome what has been a largely consensual debate this afternoon? I just wanted to take a moment to put on record my appreciation of the life of Dr. Brian Keithley, who I attended the memorial service for him yesterday, along actually with Richard Simpson and many others. In fact, it was a full house, and as a previous chair of the BMA and an involvement in medical politics going back many, many years, he's certainly a big loss to Scotland, and I would want to pass on my condolences to his family. I want to try and come back on as many comments as possible, but my apologies if I don't manage to cover them all. Richard Simpson asked for some bits of information. Can I first of all say, just in general terms, Rhoda Grant mentioned Richard's paper and the fact that we had met, and I thought it was a very productive meeting. I think it's fair to say, and I think it would be worrying if this wasn't the case, that by and large, what was in Richard Simpson's paper is already either being done or planning to be done. And I think if it wasn't the case, we'd be a bit concerned, given Richard's knowledge and the expertise of the people we've taken to build up the plan. So there is synergy there, and I think that's to be welcomed. Richard asked a number of questions. He mentioned the issue of the risk registers. I am told that they all have one in place, but you can be assured, being me, I will check that and make sure that is the case. He also referred to the role of nurses, and although, you know, there's been an understandable focus on general practice, it is absolutely the case that this is about the wider workforce in primary care, and of course the nursing workforce is critically important in that. Now, of course, he will be aware that in the last year we have seen an increase of over 500 full-time equivalent of all nursing and midwifery staff, and that's we're projecting an increase of over 600 full-time equivalents over the course of this financial year. And of course, if you also look at the investment in health visitors, a total of over £41 million over 4 years to 2018, which will increase that workforce by 500. I mean, there is a lot of investment going on around that wider workforce. But of course, as ever, there is more to be done, and we recognise that. Jim Hume talked about the level of investment. Of course, he mentioned the £40 million in 1 year becoming £60 million over 3 years. I think £60 million is still greater than £40 million, but there's always more to be done, and I'm sure he will recognise that as being a key priority for the Scottish Government as we look at the budget and beyond tomorrow. He also mentioned the issue, which a few people have done, around the percentage share of investment going into GPs. Now, of course, Jim Hume has asked me quite a lot of questions, always happy to provide answers to him, but of course, the answer he cited was a figure that was net of dispensing and reimbursement of drugs, which of course is a figure that can go down sometimes due to more efficiencies in the system. But of course, he was also provided with an answer on the expenditure on GP services, both in cash terms and in real terms, since 2007-8 to 2013-14. And of course, he would recognise that in 2007-8, the percentage, the amount of expenditure in percentage terms is 8%, and in 2013-14 it's 8.1%. Now, I merely make that point that there has been a continuity of level of investment in percentage terms, but the point has been made, which I accept, that if we are going to do more in primary care, if we are going to ensure that people can get more of their treatment in primary care, then we need to spend more in primary care. So that is hopefully a point of agreement that we can all unite around. Jackson Carlaw. Now, before I couldn't allow Jackson Carlaw to get too carried away with the supposed largesse of the UK government when it comes to health, and I want to just make this point because it is important. Jackson Carlaw cited that the Scottish Government was due to receive £800 million over the next 5 years, because presumably he's referring to the £8 billion figure that is being widely, was widely understood in terms of UK government investment. What he will fully understand, I'm sure, though, is that when you look at the budget, the UK government spending review, a good chunk of that £8 billion is within health movement of resources. So what they have done is they have moved a big chunk, removed a big chunk of investment in public health and nurse bursaries, and have moved that to the NHS. So they've redefined what they mean by the NHS to quite a narrow view, actually, of the NHS. So, of course, there are no consequentials flowing from that resource. So we would envisage that now, I think, the consequentials would be from around £4 billion, not £8 billion. So happy to follow that up in writing with Jackson Carlaw, because I think it's important that we understand that, that, you know, there has been some of that in-year movement of resources, which obviously affects what we would receive here. I think Drew Smith made a comment I want to come back on around the issue of Professor Watt's report, deep end practices, the Scottish allocation formula, the need for us to ensure that going forward there is more of a reflection of the needs of communities in deprived communities in terms of the resources that go to them through the formula. Now, all of these things are subject to negotiation around the contract, but as I've said before, I recognise very much that we need to ensure that those practices operating in more deprived communities, with all the challenges they have, that is recognised in the resources that are provided in primary care. And just to correct him around the motion, I will in a second. The motion actually very clearly says that the new contract presents the opportunity to go even further to tackle health inequalities in our communities, and I deliberately put that in to recognise that point. I'll give way to Duncan McNeill.
Duncan McNeill.
The Secretary has rightly said that more will be expected from primary care services and there will be an increased investment. How will we measure the outcomes, given that QOF is disappearing? How will people know that we're getting the outcomes for that increased investment and activity?
Cabinet Secretary.
Duncan McNeill will appreciate that there will be an interim set of arrangements in terms of the transition year, because the new contract itself is still subject to negotiation. And that's very important, and that would be a very important part of the negotiation. But actually, I think in the health service more generally, we need to move to more of an outcomes-based approach, not just for primary care, but for acute services as well as we move forward. So I can assure Duncan McNeill that that work is ongoing, and I'm very happy to keep him and other members appraised of progress as we move forward. Nanette Milne and in fact Duncan, I should say in the same way as I said to Richard Simpson, Nanette Milne's experience that she's brought as a former GP to this Parliament will also be missed in the same way as I said about Richard Simpson. But Duncan McNeill, although not a GP to trade, has over the years developed a real knowledge of health and care services, and I think as convener of the Health and Sport Committee has brought a great deal of experience, which again will be missed. Although I'm sure this will not be the last health debate that all of you as retiring members will be taking part in, and I don't want it to sound like that, but I thought it was appropriate to take the opportunity to pay tribute. Neil Findlay talked about the position in Lothian, and you know, it is fair to say that there are some parts of the country which have particular challenges, and that has a sharp focus in some parts of the country more than others. We wouldn't be here debating the future of primary care if I didn't think that we had a challenge that needed to be addressed, and I'm absolutely determined to do that. We've already made progress with the investment of £60 million over the next 3 years, the rapid dismantling of the QOF. All of that is really to send a signal, which I think is very important, and that is we want Scottish general practice to be a success story. I think it was Nanette Milne who said we need to be promoting Scottish general practice as a good place to come and work and train. And I think that's really important that we send that message, that despite some of the challenges, of which we have heard of many this afternoon, that actually with this plan and with the support and the right investment, that we can make Scottish general practice a place that doctors want to come and work in, but importantly that young medical students making
up,
their choice of which specialty to go into will choose general practice, and that we will see that coming through over the next few months and years.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on redesigning primary care for Scotland's community. Sarah Boyack has a point of order.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I ask a point of order in relation to the Stage 1 proceedings of the Land Reform Bill tomorrow? Presiding Officer, our debate on land reform is taking place at 4 p.m. and we have yet to receive the response to the committee's Stage 1 report from the Scottish Government. I understand that this is not going to aid our scrutiny of this important bill. Will the Presiding Officer be able to ask the Scottish Government to ensure we have this important report which will aid our scrutiny as soon as possible? It's now less than 24 hours before this really important debate. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I saw that the Minister for Parliamentary Business was listening very intently to your point of order. You are well aware that I have said on numerous occasions that I want as much information in the hands of members as possible to allow that debate to happen. So I would like the Minister for Parliamentary Business to consider Ms Boyack's request urgently. Thank you. The next item of business is consideration of business motion number 15186 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a revision to business programme for Wednesday 16 December 2015. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press the request to speak button now. And I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion number 15186.
Formally moved.
No member is asked to speak against the motion, therefore I now put the question to the Chamber. The question is that motion number 15186 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The motion is therefore agreed to. There are three questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is amendment number 15172.2 in the name of Richard Simpson, which seeks to amend motion number 15172 in the name of Shona Robison on redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities be agreed to. Are we all agreed? The amendment is not agreed to. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on amendment number 15172.2 in the name of Richard Simpson is as follows. Yes, 46. No, 63. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is amendment number 15172.1 in the name of Jim Hume, which seeks to amend motion number 15172 in the name of Shona Robison on redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. Vote on amendment number 15172.1 in the name of Jim Hume is as follows. Yes, 36. No, 73. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed to. The next question is that motion number 15172 in the name of Shona Robison on redesigning primary care for Scotland's communities be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed. We move to a vote. Members should cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 15172 in the name of Shona Robison is as follows. Yes, 104. No, 5. There were no abstentions. The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time. We are now moving to members' business. Members who leave the chamber should do so quickly and quietly.